Hello again. Today we have some very interesting topic, you know, in this new podcast, something that hardly any people know about. This is called velocity-based training, okay? And we have one of our colleagues, Megan, here, who has done level 2 of velocity-based training. And even the name is so scientific that probably he'll be the better person to help us understand what this velocity-based training is and how it is used. First, Megan, welcome. And I want you to first tell me, what is this velocity-based training and how did you come across doing this course? I mean,
velocity-based training is very much a newer concept. Like it has been developed in USA. There were two guys at Colorado State University who were developing this concept. Since then, they have published over 25 research papers discussing just about velocity-based training. And what they discuss is, rather than focusing on 1 RM or 5 RM or 10 RM, it's also important to take into consideration what the speed of the lift is. So if you lift any kind of weights, it's important to know what the speed of the lift is rather than just focusing on what the weight is. Because what happens is, if you don't focus on the speed and you just lift weights, you activate, sometimes you activate the muscles you don't necessarily need in your sport or in your lift. That is like, that was the concept behind their research. Like you just need to activate what is necessary and you need to activate according to your sport.
So does that mean that people have to, like other athletes or especially athletes, because it is looks like more of athlete-centric kind of activity rather than a generic one for fitness. So is it that you control the speed of that particular weight training or how is it like? You know, you're talking about like they have to understand what speed they lift up that weight with. So if you can just give an example of say maybe overhead push. Okay.
So imagine GPS technologies which we know. They track how much you have traveled, they track how you have traveled it, and they get you all the metrics. So in the same place, like we place the same amount of sensors on the weights. So what they do is, when the weights go down and up, so in an overhead push, you need to go from a 90 degree shoulder flex position to a overhead 180 degree complete push. So at that point of time, you need to understand how much weight you are pushing and at what meters per second you are pushing. So it's calculated according to that sensors. They have accelerometer, they have gyrometers, all in that sensors, which kind of help you get the meters per second metric for any weight training. What that does is, it helps you develop the force. Like imagine a shot put player who uses that muscle a lot and he has that action. So what he needs to do is, he needs to push it as fast as he can. So for him, the velocity based training will be at much higher amounts, rather than probably a gymnastic or an artistic gymnastic player who needs to do handstand but in a very slow motion. So he'll have a very slow velocity based training. So that's where it varies.
So one more just kind of a parallel question I have it in mind, that is it something to do with the hypertrophy of the muscle as well, or is it only the muscle endurance that we are talking about?
It's more to do with, it actually has a lot to do with the strength, not related to hypertrophy or muscle toning much, but strength development. What the concept of velocity based training is, that you can develop equal amount of strength by lifting some maximum amount of weights. So hypertrophy, I think, is a subset of that. Like it comes along with that.
Okay. So if an athlete, say let us take an example of a sprinter, so who probably has, you know, has his main event of a 200 meter sprint. So versus an athlete who is probably a cyclist, if you say. Mm-hmm. So where the power generation is so different from a sprinter, but both athletes uses their lower limbs. So how do you kind of in a small, you know, brief that you need to understand, how do you differentiate their velocity based training from one to the other?
So let's just take it for example, squat. Squat as a exercise for both of the cyclist as well as the runners. So for runner, imagine he's a 100 meter sprinter. For a 100 meter sprinter, the event doesn't last more than 15 seconds. That's like tops. 10 seconds is the world class level right now. So for him, we'll be doing 3 to 5 reps or maybe even more than that, but in a very fast paced manner. While the cyclist, they go at a steady pace for longer distance, so he needs more muscle endurance. So for him, velocity will be more sustained rather than so imagine a graph. For cyclists, the graph will be plateauing at the same velocity. Like imagine if the velocity is 1 meter per second, cyclist will show the same velocity for each rep, while for a sprinter the velocity should go as fast as he can, like 2, 3, 4 meters per second. That's fine.
Alright. So basically, as I understand that, you know, there are two things to it. One, when you mentioned that there are certain sensors which are applied to the weights and you kind of measure actually the speed with. And I would obviously want to kind of just make sure that all our viewers do understand that just by listening to this particular idea, you cannot just from tomorrow start training your athletes with less velocity or more velocity depending on what it is. There's a science behind the whole concept that they have. Not every time you have the sensors and all the technology backup that you want to, but with actually having those principles, you can still partly work towards benefiting an athlete. So, just a word of caution to all our viewers, you should not just take this principle and start implementing it right away from the next day to or from now to your athletes. You have to understand that there's a lot of science that goes behind understanding velocity based. Okay.
Absolutely.
Anything else that you want to add to this particular
thing? One thing more. It should be a bit of binary. Like you should know what you're getting into when you're trying velocity based training. And the other thing is, the equipments required for velocity based training are pretty expensive according to the Indian standards. So even if you think about buying one, know its uses. Like you cannot use it for every lift. You should use it for the main lifts right now, because that's what the research says. You cannot keep on using it for lunges and for leg press. No, it should be just used for functional compound main lifts like squats, deadlift and bench press, because that's what the research states right now, and which people don't understand. People just use these methods and principles and they kind of apply it everywhere on the basis of tempo based training.
So now that you've mentioned earlier that there are close to 20-25 research papers that has been done on this particular topic, do you follow any of the, we can say, velocity based training people who have conceptualized this, or you know, somebody who's practicing it very routinely and they have come across some fabulous results out of it? Are you following them in terms of with the beat on social media, or be it reading about them a little more?
Oh, absolutely. There are two people actually. There is Dr. Jacob of Core Advantage in Australia, and then there is Dr. Brian, I don't remember his surname, sorry, but he's said to be the founder of Velocity Based Training, and he is in Colorado State University in the States.
Any kind of one striking feature that you would kind of say that yes, this is something that attracted you towards learning velocity based training, like something which you read about and that, like, you know, kind of gave you a complete awe and you said, no, this is something that we need to.
It's more related to, like, me being a lazy person, this is lazy athletes training guide. Like what they basically advertised it as is work less, work smart, but gain more. Like if you use submaximal loads, you still gain maximal strength. And they actually compared this in two research papers, which were phenomenal. Like they were randomized controlled trials, and there were two sets. One was using submaximal but velocity based training. One was using maximal but without velocity based training. Both showed the same results. So why work more and then get more? Like more, like they say, more pain, more gain. But here the concept was quite different.
Different is more of using scientific principles in training, which probably can not only give an advantage to the athletes, but also reduce, not technically, but reduce their workload maybe in terms of the amount of efforts that they want to put in. If you're going to get similar results by putting in less efforts, but scientifically correct efforts, I think it's a win-win situation for the athletes as well. Yeah, so cool. I guess something very new, something very different, and I guess very, very few people probably know about this velocity-based training, and it is definitely a concept that we need to build on and make sure that we implement this in our routine athlete development program. And long way to go, but yes, we'll be there. Thank you, Megan. Thank you for your insights, and looking forward to some other topic next time.
Thank you
so much. Okay.